started, I'm going to apologize, I don't have as good a preparation this week because my eye didn't open up until this afternoon, so, you know, it's not real complicated what we have, so, do we have any announcements?
Keith says Burnett's doing a little better, he saw him today, he's walking with a walker now, and somebody just said Nellie and Betty are still in Kentucky. Donna, Shirley, okay?
Yeah, she just had to go and get this.
Only five, but then you were one. You were one.
I really was grateful that Keith and Stephen and Mark and Marty were able to go with us to Jack's funeral yesterday. And it was just a small little group, but it was nice.
Guess that's it all, sir, for our Almighty Father, we come here giving thanks for this opportunity we have together as Christians, to commemorate your Son, his sacrifice that he made, the love that he had for us, and your love that we would willingly allow him to die for our sins. We thank you for the Bible that tells us your plan of salvation and reveals your word of us. We thank you for our fellowship and study we have together here, and for the church existing in its first century form to the best of its possibilities to do so. We pray that you'll be with us in our studies, that you'll help guide us and discover the truth and apply it to our lives, and remember that when we sin, we deliberately and knowingly, we are nailing Jesus ourselves to the cross, so help us to not to yield in to temptation and sin willingly and knowingly, and to hurt your Son, and to hurt our own selves by participating in this sin. We ask that you'll be with those of the congregation who are sick, Kaija Holstein, Deb Rossi, Amy Rossi, Bridget Stewart, Deb Rossi's two brothers who are undergoing treatment for cancer, Shan Wood is in his treatments, and everyone else that has been neglected to be mentioned or forgotten, that you'll watch over them, heal them, restore them to their health if possible, if not, be with them, loving and comforting them and guiding them. We pray that you'll be with Jack's family, that you'll heal them in their time of loss, and that you'll be with them always. We ask these things in Christ's name. Amen. Okay, tonight we start Matthew 15:21. Are there any questions before we get started? Okay, a little background here. These verses are going to reflect back, not directly, but reflects the same attitude of a Gentile as the centurion did that sent his servants to Jesus to heal his servant that was dying. So, once again, the Gentiles have great faith sometimes, and it reflects here. So, we're going to get started. And Jesus went away from there and withdrew to the district of Tyre and Sidon. And behold, a Canaanite woman from that region came out and cried out, "Have mercy on me, O Lord, Son of David. My daughter is severely possessed by a demon." But he did not answer her a word. And his disciples came and begged him, saying, "Send her away, for she is crying after us." And he answered, "I was sent to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." But she came and knelt before him, saying, "Lord, help me." And he answered, "It is not fair to take the children's bread and throw it to the dogs." She said, "Yes, Lord, yet even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table." Then Jesus answered her, "O woman, great is your faith. Be it done as you desire." And her daughter was instantly healed. These verses here, besides the centurion's belief, what do they make you think about in her confession to him? What does she have that a lot of the Jews don't have faith in? thinking she sees him as the Messiah. And a lot of the Jews don't see that because she says, "Oh Lord, Son of David," and that right there is her confession of possible faith in him as the Messiah. Because she's using Lord and the Son of David, both the mentioning what position he holds. Anyone see any differences or want to add to make that clear?
I think that's right on.
You know, some people's faith, it's amazing that, you know, she hasn't been following Jesus, but she's heard what he's done. And she's, you know, a good ways away from where he's been ministering. I mean, not a great distance. Let me take a look at the map here and I'll give you an estimate. Maybe 30, 40 miles away from Galilee. In that range, 30, 40, 50 miles. And yet she has a belief that the people in his hometown and the area around the Sea of Galilee didn't have. That, you know, she had heard what he had done. And she's here confessing him as, you know, the Son of David, O Lord, which is the term that the Jews would use instead of Adonai, instead of Jehovah, because they weren't allowed to use Jehovah, but that's used 200 times to refer to Jesus in it's used 200 times by Paul in his writings, and I don't know how many times in the rest of the New Testament, but Paul uses Lord alone, referring to Jesus 200 times. And, you know, it's probably at least that much or more through the rest of the New Testament. So that is the confirmation that he is God. And that's interesting because he calls the Gentiles dogs, and she's not offended by it. She says, "Yes, Lord." Yet even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from the master's table. And then, you know, Jesus says, "Oh, woman, great is your faith. Be it done for you as you desire."
Do you think the fact that they say little dogs, that maybe it's just not quite as harsh as...
Mine says the Greek says little dogs, meaning a pet dog in the home.
You know, yeah, you know, you can't say one translation's better than the others, you know, but one says little dogs, you know, and I'm sure it's referring to that because, you know, they did have dogs as pets and there was also wild packs of dogs, so it's probably referring to little dogs because it wasn't, you know, she's not a wild, ravening, dangerous creature.
The NIV, the way it says it, is he replied, "It is not right to take the children's bread and toss it to their dogs."
I don't think Jesus ever was like name calling except when he was talking to the Pharisees and Sadducees. He was never mean to the common person.
Do you think that part of the lesson here was for the benefit of his disciples? They were trying to obviously he knows that the gospel is soon going to go to all the world.
Yeah, I think that's exactly right. I mean, you know, he's teaching a lesson to them besides showing that, you know, the Gentiles are going to be saved eventually, because they're saying, send her away. You know, he goes on and uses the dog reference for her, but that's not really how he felt about her, because she had believed.
I see that as almost him parroting the spirit of the age on the part of the Jews. To me, he's kind of like trying to heal a little bit of a big piece of prejudice or thinking on the part of his disciples here.
Yeah.
And he borrows from their own expression and calling the Gentiles dogs, but then he performs the miracle and he praises her for having great faith, which has to be really eye-opening to his disciples.
To me, it feels like almost like gentle sarcasm, or he's doing this to make a point. You know, kind of like almost like a teaching method or something.
Oh yeah, I think that's exactly right, because you know they hadn't learned from the, you know, where they had healed the centurion servant, that, you know, it was still going to be given to the Gentiles. The difference there is because leaders of the local synagogues come and said, this man has built us a synagogue and he's a friend of the Jews, you know, please help me. And this woman had no one intervening for him. So, you know, the crowd was looking at her to say, get this dog away from us. Get, you know, she's unworthy. Don't, you know. The other case, you know, you have the leaders of the synagogue saying, you know, take mercy upon this man. He's a good man. He's helped us, you know. Which kind of shows that they believe in Jesus, these Jewish leaders there. But, and I'm not sure, Terry, has the Samaritan woman been healed at this point that had come and begged? Well, the water, where she draws the water for him. Has this occurred yet?
I think that's later because John's gospel kind of picks
Yeah, you know what? You're right. I think so.
But it's similar to that. Is that the disciples didn't have any compassion. So, and Jesus didn't answer. So he's teaching them something. Because they're so tied up with their, you know, their teachings of Jesus, which we can be occupied with today. Their own spiritual things, and they're, you know, all to themselves. They don't recognize the help of evil.
They were kind of worried about who's going to be on this right and left side, you know, and didn't have time for the children, sent them away. So maybe they were getting a little bit of the big head being part of this away, you know, part of the crowd.
Okay, Bob, can you get your hand up too?
Yeah, I think there's a whole lot of things going on in these verses.
Yes.
First of all, why did Jesus go to the region?
I think he did win it for this reason alone.
Simply, I think it was just a teaching opportunity to his disciples. And it shows that the Gentiles had the same infirmities that the Jews did. You know, this woman's daughter was possessed with a demon, and she realizes that Jesus has the power and the ability to heal her. And, you know, Jesus calls her a little dog, whether, and I think it is sarcasm, I think it's playing on to his disciples, saying, you know, you're a Gentile, get away from me. And this woman has such great faith that Jesus heals her. And I think the whole thing is a teaching tool to his disciples that look at the faith that the Gentiles have. And then compare it to what the Jews have. And he's coming to them first, but yet go back to the centurion. He says, you don't even have to come to my house. Just say the word and be healed. But there was so much more faith on the side of the Gentiles than on the Jews.
It's like he was testing the woman and his disciples at the same time.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. He's ignoring her and saying, you know,
see how
I didn't come to you, I come to the house of Israel, you're a little dog, get away from me. And she keeps pleading, you have the ability to heal, and he says, because of your faith, you're
many of us today, if we were asking for the same favor, would you call us a little dog, or I'm not, you know, ministering to your type of people? How many of us would we kept persisting?
I'm sure that we would be offended or, you know, angry or whatever, and resentful to that, to Jesus for saying that to us. Yet she continued to believe because she knew that he had the ability to heal.
For what it's worth, Matthew uses the word he, in verse 21, that he went away and withdrew into the district of Tyre and Sidon. And I think there's more of a, it's not just that he went there away from where he was, but Mark's gospel says it this way: from there he arose and went away to the Tyre, to the region of Tyre. And then it says here, which Matthew doesn't record, and when he had entered a house, he wanted no one to know of it, yet he could not escape notice. So back to your, or Bob's question, or whoever asked why, maybe it was Maggie, who asked why did he go up there in the first place? I mean, God knows all, so there's no doubt he could foresee that Syro-Phoenician woman. But it sounds like he was trying to seek rest or time away from the crowds, and he didn't want to be known. Keith, you disagree? Talk so we can hear you back here.
Jesus didn't limit his ministry to only to the Jews. So this was shown that he went also to the Gentiles. And he was trying to show his disciples, which were Jews, the attitude of hypocrisy. And the woman didn't, Jesus wasn't degrading this woman, but he was showing the reflection of what the Jews were.
Well, that's how,
because the Jews treated the Gentiles like dogs, because they were no more in favor of receiving the gospel than the Gentiles. Yeah.
He went into that house, and it seemed like he was seeking secrecy of some kind, or at least, well, what do you do with that verse, Keith?
Well, this is the only time he went out of Jewish territory, which might have been the reason why he was going to this territory, was for rest or to get out of the crowd, but he couldn't, because this woman came.
That's in Mark 7:24. Anyway, it's not a big point, but
you know, I'm not saying that any of these points are brought up is wrong. I mean, they all contain certain valid truths to them. You know, Jesus probably did want to give away, because he's thinking that, you know, he's got about 9 to 10 months before he's crucified and it's starting to wear on him. You know, no matter where he goes, his fame spreads before him.
We see a lot of examples where Jesus needed to get away from the crowds and his disciples and his apostles, just one-on-one with his father to be probably recharged. He was, it was a stressful. He knew that the Jews were out to kill him.
Previously, it tells how he withdrew when John the Baptist had been executed, and he didn't go to the Passover that year. So yeah, he, you know, it's not wrong to say he needed the rest either. I mean, he may be going to the Gentiles to teach, but you know, we're not all so simple that one answer describes what our behavior is. You know,
sometimes we think he's Jesus. You know, he ought to be tough, but he's fully human, and that's just hard to wrap our minds around, that even though he's God in the flesh, he is also tasting humanity in its fullness. So yeah, all of these things had to be weighing on him as a human. How could they not? I mean, just think of the anxieties that we deal with. deal with from day to day and week to week, all of us in different ways, and they weigh on us in different ways, but then again, maybe that which sustained it was that time to withdraw, to talk to God and quiet, you know.
I don't think either answer is wrong.
No. That verse doesn't say you might be impressed.
Well, it doesn't say that in Matthew, or in Mark.
Did I say to rest?
That's what you said.
No, I didn't. I never did.
You said you just wanted to keep it secret. You couldn't keep it secret where it was.
Read your verse.
When he was up Galilee and went north of the region of Tyre, he didn't want anyone to know which house he was staying in, but he couldn't keep it secret.
That was my point. He went up there to withdraw.
I think what he's trying to say is he couldn't keep it a secret. He wanted to keep it a secret, but he couldn't keep it a secret.
We're speculating, in addition to that, why did he go there? You know, if we went up there to withdraw so that he couldn't be found, why? So maybe he didn't need to rest from the pressures of the crowd.
Did he use up energy when he was doing the healing?
It's a good question.
The woman touched his hand.
Healing, I mean, did it take something from him?
You know what? I'm sure it took some kind of psychic energy, whatever you want to call it, psychic, I mean, what, spiritual, psychic, whatever. I'm sure it took a lot from him.
Well, when the woman touched his garment,
yeah.
He knew that she was
powerful now. And it was like all that. I'm not sure it was.
He fell off. Awesome.
If it's like, that movie, The Green Mile. I mean, that really took a toll on that man.
And you know,
if
we, after we go a little further, you know, the crowds are following him. For 3 days, he's performing miracles. So, you know, maybe that's why he needed to rest.
Kind of puts the human side on Jesus a little bit.
Yeah, I mean, not just the human. When you think of him being God, you know, he knows what, you know, he's doing for the people that are ungrateful. You know, it says no one's worthy of salvation. It's, we all get it by grace. And, you know, he knows that he's going to die and take the sins of the world, the sins, the sorrow, the grief, you know, the pain and suffering of the whole world from beginning to the end upon him. And, you know, what's that weigh upon him? You know, he's fully human. Yet he's aware of the God part, and what's that doing to him and inside mentally? You know, I think we ought to be so thankful that he had the love, and God had the love to send him and allow this to happen. That, you know,
it wouldn't take me a year to recover from a 4 mile walk on the water.
Don't make me laugh.
That hurts.
And you know, when all these crowds and these lots of people were coming to Jesus to be healed of sicknesses or pain or infirmities or whatever they had, I don't know that they were coming there because they felt that he was the Messiah. They were coming there to get something from him. They were just coming there to be healed. So, I mean, that had to be an emotional drain for Jesus too, that even though that's what he was doing, these people that were coming to him were only coming to get something from him. You know what I mean?
Yep.
I like that point, and it makes me think how the verse that says he had compassion on them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. Given that he was compassionate, even if they were just coming to get something, they were so needy because they were ill and things like that. And to see a sea of people like that, that were so hurting, must have been, just that alone must have been emotionally exhausting, you know, just to see that that scope of neediness, and to know that they were all wanting something from him.
And then he realizes that they don't really want him a lot of some of them might, you know, want his...
What he can do for them.
Yeah, mostly they want what he can do for them, not that they want to follow him. They're just want what they can give.
Are we that way sometimes?
Oh, yeah. I've been that way. I'm still that way at times, you know. I mean, I think if anyone's honest, they got to answer yes.
It's human nature.
Yeah, but you think, like, if somebody goes to law, you maybe can get them law. Now, sure, they would be very well pleased if they were law, but don't you think that they would really think about power that it took to do that and worship Jesus, I would say, because like the blind, you could see again. How would you feel? You know, put yourself in their shoes years ago. If you were blind and somebody made you see, you wouldn't think it was just a part that you got something, but you would think about how you got it.
If you know yourself, human nature, at the moment, yes, you're right with it, but then time goes by and it wears off, and that's human nature.
Well, I'll give you a for instance. Today, everybody in here, sometime in their life, seen the light. And what it didn't take them to be able to see again, or walk again, or move their arm, or whatever, they see the light. And to me, I think that 9 out of 10 of them people would see the light.
You talk about the leprosy healed, and only one thing. I mean, that's, you got to keep in mind that human nature has a big role in this.
Yeah, but,
you know, I think he's right to a certain extent. A lot of people are going to appreciate it. But I think a lot of people, when they seen him crucified too, said, oh, he's not who we thought he was. So, you know, maybe half of the people that he had healed said, he's not the Messiah. How could he let himself be killed? Well, maybe when he was resurrected, you know, they changed their mind. But we know very well his apostles was with him all that time, and all they seen, and what happened? There was only one of them that was there at his death, and that was John. You know, and on the Sunday morning when he arose, only two of them actually went to the tomb, and that was Peter and John, and his mother and the Marys. So, you know.
But we're the same way when things are going bad. We doubt that Jesus, I'm not saying we, but people doubt that God is with them because some awful hurricane or disease or some whatever is happening in their life, they're thinking God's not with us because things are great. And we're kind of the same way in a different manner. When things are going great and we are healed to see the light, then it's fine. But when things are going bad...
Yeah. And when things keep going good, we start to think we're doing it ourselves.
That's
true. You know, I don't think Richard's wrong. I really don't. I think that a lot of people, though, will respond just like you say, but a lot of them will eventually have their doubts, you know. That's like he says, human nature. You know, I've been through a lot lately, and I'll tell you what, each thing I go through makes me stronger and more of a believer than I was before, you know. 2 years ago, I wasn't anything like I am now. You know, I'm not saying I was an awful person, but, you know, I'm not what I am now. I have a desire now to do that, which is right, you know.
Unless by someone smacked you in the face and woke you up.
Yeah, it was my brother, because he kept making those calls to me to come to church.
What's amazing about Jesus' power to me, this woman has to heal her daughter, just like the other woman, the centurion came to Jesus. She begged for He healed those people without even knowing them. You know what I mean?
But some of the people that he helped, that healed, he
didn't even have to see them. He didn't even touch them.
to somebody, he said, you have, he told that woman, you have great faith. You have great faith. But he healed masses, and he didn't say anything about that. Yeah, out of great faith.
And that verses.
Well, I think I'm going to call it for the night. I'm sorry, but, you know, it's a little early, but it's kind of hard for me to keep talking. We're not going to go any further, but anyone who wants to ask questions or, you know, make comments, go ahead. But we're not going to go any further in the verses that we know so far. So.
Well, even though this stuff like isn't deep and profound, it's good to discuss this stuff because it kind of makes us look at ourselves and, you know, helps ourselves. So it's good discussion even though it's not profound knowledge that we're getting. It's good to
have. And you know, I'd say that 90% of the stuff we say in here is all correct in one way or another. You know, if someone disagrees with you, it doesn't mean you're wrong. It just means that they don't see the thing the same way you are. I can see what Richard's saying. I can see what Dick's saying there. You know,
it's like a cut gemstone. It has a lot of facets, and you can't see them all at one time.
Comment, that's good.
And if everybody agreed with everybody else, we wouldn't have there, would we?
No.
Even scholars have said that if the all four gospels got completely along on every single aspect of details of that, means that it would have been a corroborative effort. It would always be very little historical base or truth.
Yeah, but I read that all the time. Yeah, they say that's a contradiction. It's not a contradiction. It's just, if each of us would go out and return after witnessing something and write what we see, we would agree on some things, we would disagree on others, you know. That's just, yeah. The history is wrote at the Revolution, don't all agree. You know, the history is wrote during World War II, don't all agree. We wrote that in our histories that we beat the Japanese by using the atomic bomb. The Russians wrote that they beat them because they poured 3.5 million people across the border of Manchuria and took as much territory in 1 month as the Americans and the British did in 4 years. So, you know, who's right, who's wrong? Maybe they're both right. You know, maybe the Japanese just said, you know, the end's on its way, and when they seen Hiroshima, they knew that, you know, it's done. So who's right and who's wrong there? Nothing else. Terry, you want to say something? I know you do.
No.
I thought I seen you mouth working.
No, very good. I'm just playing with my word.
Okay, I guess if no one has anything else, that would use you.
It's been a busy week for a lot of us. So this Sunday, we have class to leaders. Next Wednesday is Simple Supper, I believe.
Yeah.
Now, we don't have life groups next Sunday, right?
We don't this coming Sunday, but we meet here.
Okay, we're on the regular 6:30 Sunday night meeting then. Okay, so. Anything else? Number 792, number 792.
My prayers are cold.
Father, again, we're grateful that we can be here again to study your word. Help us to take your word into our lives and take it out to the streets of people. Be your body. Help us to show it that Jesus is love. He accepts everyone. Father, we know that you have done it again to come down in the morning. Thank you again, Father, for the blessings you give to us. We pray for us to go with you. Be according to your will, that you bring him back to us healthy, that we can worship together as a family. Believe us. Thank you again for the Son of God.
I think it's me.